So the snows began to melt. A lot of the southern slopes and southern areas are actually melted off now. And that's where a few of these apple trees are that we want to go in and prune. So we're heading in there. We're going to basically analyze this whole stretch of trees. We got a half dozen to look at, and we're going to just start cutting them back. So a lot of these trees are unmanaged, they're overgrown, obviously wild trees that have never been pruned up or anything in the past. So when we find these fruit trees, these apple trees, you know, it does take a lot of work to get them back into a good production phase. Basically the first thing we do is we look at them, overall shape, overall health. Is it a tree we want to even mess with, or is it mostly dead or diseased, or you know, what's kind of the current state of the tree? Most of them look pretty good, they're just wild and grown kind of back into themselves. They need a little bit of work, but basic concept is open up the canopy, let sunlight come in. That's for pollination, and that's so the tree can actually dry out earlier in the day. So if the tree stays real dense and thick, it's gonna, you know, have moisture, bacteria, fungus, and disease is a higher potential. If you open the canopy and you let that sunlight and that airflow go through, really allows for more pollination and more benefits to the tree. So we're out here on the Cedar Springs property. Found a lot of apple trees in the past year and a half, so we're out here, we're trying to prune them up, get them more productive. A lot of these didn't really produce apples or any fruit, so just kind of looking at overall shape. This one's extremely crooked, so it's going to be tough to analyze, but trying to kind of reshape it to produce some apples and, you know, get some production out of that, so the wildlife actually have something on the ground this fall when we're out hunting. So we'll start with this one, and then we'll just work our way around to different trees. So this branch here had quite a bit of broken tips on it, just really messed up, and is actually hanging really low. So a lot of dead stuff on that branch, just kind of getting it out of the way. I'm just gonna work on some of the easy stuff first, some of the dead branches on the end. Trying to get really clean cuts so a tree can heal over, not get infected. Put a little back cut on it, and when you come down on your main cut, it's not going to want to peel the bark off. Another thing is we look at the limbs. We want to keep some nice main limbs that are more horizontal. These are stronger limbs. These actually produce more fruit. Anything that's grown vertical, or a lot of trees, you'll see these shoots, these water shoots, where there's just dozens of these little thin branches that shoot straight up, grow straight up vertically. Those don't produce fruit very well at all. So we want to trim all those water sprouts, promote horizontal growth, and hopefully we get a lot more fruit production on the tree from that as well. One other key thing is we want to look for branches that are growing back into the tree or touching or rubbing on each other. That exposure, that rubbing actually allows for certain funguses and disease to penetrate and get inside the tree, infect the tree. So we want to remove all dead branches and all branches that are rubbing or growing back into the tree. So those are just a couple of things we're looking for. Each tree out here, again, it's wild. They're in all different conditions, so it's hard to put one blueprint on every tree, but we look at them, do our best, and just try to promote the tree and get as much benefit to the deer and the wildlife as possible moving into this next season. It's actually looking really good. So I'm taking some of these water sprouts or water shoots off the base of the tree here, and the ones that were coming out of the ground. Basically that's just pulling nutrients out of the tree that we want to go up into the eventual fruit that's going to grow off the tree. So just trying to get more nutrition up to the top and hopefully produce more fruit with all the things we've done cleaning up this tree. Thank you. All right, so we just got done trimming this tree. First one we've done, it was real wild. Had a bunch of grapevines in there from last year that was just holding it all together, a lot of broken stuff. So just really cleaned it up. Took out probably 30-40% of the tree, which is pretty aggressive, but it's the dormant season. It's still mid-March, so everything's pretty cold here still. A lot of snow on the ground and stuff. So tree's dormant. Hopefully this really sparks some growth and a lot more fruit production this year for the wildlife. So we got a stand that'll be maybe 75 yards away from this tree in a nice spot. So it's just one more thing to attract wildlife, keep them on your property, and hopefully use for a hunting strategy later on in the season. So we're gonna move on. We got about 16 more trees, so I don't think any of them are quite this bad, but we'll just keep plucking away at them. So pruning these trees actually takes quite a bit of time because they are in such rough shape. So, you know, we're just taking one at a time. Maybe we can do two in a day or a couple a week. As we move forward on this process, you know, we realized there's this gigantic apple tree out there that was just so overgrown we didn't even really know it was a fruit tree, and it's just massive. It's probably a 50 plus year old tree. We named it the mega apple tree, and we're going in to basically reclaim this tree, give it some sunlight again, put all these pruning methods in place, and try to really bring up the health level of this tree.
So we've been keeping our eyes open for assets, fruit tree assets. We stumbled upon this monster apple tree. It's kind of a three-pronged base right here, and it's a mess. It's never been taken care of. Obviously, it's wild grown for all these years. And so what we want to do is we want to clean up around it, give it some sun, give it some air, give it some space, and then trim it up and see if we can't bring it back.
So we're just going to take out some of these box elders on the side that are kind of crowding it out. So we'll just start on the edges and then work our way toward the middle and see what we can do. It's not a real precise job. It's more of just a bulk kind of clean out to try to get some sun in there. There you go, okay, now, yeah, that's good. Oh! Woo! Landed right in the right spot.
According to plan.
So we're at the final stages of pruning cleanup right now. Taking out a couple of vines that are still trying to grow up into this tree, but we cleaned out, I don't know, probably 40% of this tree. It was a lot of dead stuff, a bunch of trees overhanging it, box elders, and a bunch of junk and stuff. So really cleaned it out. You can see the canopy is really nice, wide open. Did have one issue up top that we couldn't quite reach, just kind of a dead clump up top, throwing a little bit of shade on the tree, but overall, looks pretty good. A lot of open air coming through here, and we even kept a little fruit tree over there to the left. Hopefully there's some cross pollination there too. So we're gonna call it the mega apple, and that'll kind of give us a spot to relate to when we talk hunting strategies, tree stand placements, thing like that. But we got a nice spring right below it, so hopefully we can dig that out, have a little water hole, get a bunch of fruit dropping in there, and hopefully early season it's just a killer spot. So pretty excited about it, and long couple hours, but we got the job done. So heading into this spring, we still have a lot of projects, a lot of little things. You know, we're just looking to improve the property in as many ways as possible. So we're gonna continue on these fruit trees, putting them back in a healthy condition so we got more fruit production. We're gonna continue to shed hunt a little bit. We have a logger coming in this week to see if it's worth, you know, taking some of these bigger trees out, removing those canopies and bringing more light into the ground. So, you know, just a lot of little things. We're mapping soon with Andy. We're gonna walk through and really do an in-depth look at the hinge cuts. We're throwing in some switchgrass in some areas to create some cover, some depth, and a little bit more bedding. So we're going to do a little switchgrass testing this year in this little third of an acre, half an acre area. Just kind of a test this year. We're going to try to do a broadcast with the seed, and then spray a pre-emergent, and then also the Roundup on it. Just kind of kill everything off, and then hopefully we get a nice stand of switchgrass in here this summer, and then again in the following years, it'll just keep getting stronger and thicker. Good visual barrier for us to get in and out of stands and move around this area of the property without bumping all the deer out. Right now it was just an open field with some ryegrass that you can see, so not a very good entry point for hunting this spot where all the big apples are. We get the mega apple back here in the timber not too far, so we're just trying to get some screening in here by using switchgrass, and then we might even add some Egyptian wheat this spring as well. So we'll just kind of strategize it, but this is more of a test plot for switchgrass, and just, we'll see what happens going into the season. There it is.
To me, this is one of the neatest features of the property. This is fresh spring water coming directly out of the hillsides. It's a limestone filtered water, fresh spring water. And this particular setup was put in, could be close to 100 years ago, when they had cattle pastures. They needed to water the cattle. And so they drive these pipes into the hillside, and they get to that spring level of water right where the loam and the limestone meet, and that spring water is coming filtered directly out of the hill. This is one of the coolest things on the whole property, and it sure is advantageous when you don't have a field pump out there to fill up your spray concoctions.
This is the type of switchgrass that'll stand up pretty much most of the winter, and then it springs back. When the snow does melt off, it'll just spring right back up. It won't break off. So it's called Caven Rock switchgrass, and seed is actually really small. We got a little bit less than a half acre, so we're gonna put down 4 pounds of the switchgrass and just spread it out even. Hopefully we have a little bit left over, and then we can maybe hit it twice and just make sure it's nice and even across the whole field. So and go from there. Yeah, a lot of work left to do. Fire up the chainsaws one more time, but then we have to get into turkey season, look for some rails, and you know, start doing some other small projects around the property too. So we're just excited about spring and summer and what's to come in 2020.